You're listening to BioTalk with Rich Bendis, the only podcast focused on the biohealth capital region. Each episode, we'll talk to leaders in the industry to break down the biggest topics happening today in biohealth.
Hi, this is Rich Bendis. Today we have a guest from Colombia, and it's George Davis, the new CEO, and I don't know if news appropriate now, George, but the new CEO for TEDCO. And George is going to tell us about himself, tell us about TEDCO, his goals, his vision, how he's going to transform Maryland. And George, welcome to the show.
Hi, Rich. Glad to be here. And by the way, that's Columbia, Maryland.
What did I say?
You said Columbia. I just want to make sure everybody knows Columbia, Maryland.
Oh, yeah. Okay. It's not Bogota, Columbia.
No, exactly.
Okay, very good.
And you're right. I effective next week, I will have been at the helm here at TEDCO for 6 months.
Oh, my God.
So I got it all figured out.
Does it feel like 6 years?
It feels like about 60 years. But I think I got it all figured out.
That's great. You know, what we're going to find out first about you is a little bit about your background, because a lot of people don't know George Davis yet. So tell the listeners a little bit about where you came from, what your experience has been, and then we're going to transition into why in the heck did you ever go into economic development and some government work?
Yeah, I can't wait for that question.
Yeah.
So thanks, Rich. I'm a Maryland person. I was raised outside of Baltimore in a little town called Arbutus, Maryland. Claim to fame there was Governor Bobby Ehrlich. I actually grew up with Bob as a young guy. After going away to school, I came back in the early 80s and took a job at Westinghouse Electric over at the airport. So this was pre-Northrop Westinghouse. So I was a government contractor for 16 years, working with some of the brightest minds, even to this day, I've ever worked with in system engineering, electrical engineering, building military avionics. So, you know, I built fire control radar systems for F-16s and advanced tactical fighters. Learned a tremendous amount about, I'm not an engineer, but I was able to move into operations roles there and eventually program management by just watching, listening, and learning how to build equipment. Great experience. The last year there, I jumped a ship and went over and ran a group that focused on U.S. Postal Service business. So we built barcode sorting equipment, stamp machines, a lot of optical things, and landed a mobile contract in the mid-90s with the Postal Service to look at tracking carriers. Had no idea what we were doing. An old partner of mine from Westinghouse who had left to start a company in that space, I recruited back in. One thing led to the other, and I ended up jumping Westinghouse and go with my first startup with him in 1996. A very early day mobile and wireless play. You know, this is back when we were trying to put mobile products on Palm Pilots and Microsoft CE devices, right? And going over archaic packet data networks, no bandwidth. But we had some really smart engineers and created the secret we thought was to build high-end applications and find marquee customers. So we focused in the financial sector, transportation sector, got contracts with Merrill Lynch, Charles Schwab. And lo and behold, there was a little thing going on called the .com. We wrote it, went public in 99 with a company called Aether Systems out of Owings Mills, Maryland, raised $120 million. 6 months later, in March of 2000, we went back to the markets and did a secondary and raised $1.5 billion.
That's real money.
3 weeks before the markets collapsed. So I learned a lot about the upside. It was cool. I learned a lot about the downside. It was hard, but a tremendous learning experience. So we built a pretty big company, up to about 1,000 employees, ended up selling off a lot of the divisions. And there's a lot of Aether people in the world today. They're just working for different companies. Was recruited after that to run a public company called Avitech out of Baltimore, which was a big reseller of AutoCAD products from Autodesk. So we had a nationwide sales force, engineering services, and it was a public company. It shouldn't have been. You know, 50, 60 million in sales trying to be public. You know how tough that can be. So the only thing I could figure out to do to create value is to make it bigger and generate cash. And so I got it into a cash machine, merged it with a company out of Canada, doubled its size. And I probably would have ran that for a while, but I took a time out to go learn about life sciences. I did that by becoming a cancer patient, unfortunately. So I was diagnosed with cancer in 2009, entered into the Hopkins system, and 3 or 4 years later, I came through it with flying colors, but it was a tough journey. Learned a tremendous amount of perspective about myself, about life, about business, about everything. But I needed something to do. Regrouped with an old partner from Aether, and we started a small fund in Baltimore called Gamma 3, focused on doing early stage investing. We saw which I think you have seen for many years, Rich, and we all have in Maryland. What's going on with this gap between such a rich plethora of assets, yet so far behind the curve on venture capital and new business creation, comparatively? And we said, can we help? You know, so we put a small thing together, $5-6 million, and we invested in mostly tech transfer opportunities out of Hopkins in Maryland, APL. We had some good connections there. We found some good technology, cherry-picked, did some licensing. I figured out the tech transfer thing, right?
You did?
Right. One of the hardest things I've ever done.
You'd be the first one to do that.
Nightmare. Fortunately, there's some good changes going on there, but boy, what a horrible process. So we invested in six life science companies, ranging from genome analytics, we're an early player in PGDX, to tissue engineering and regenerative medicine with Gemstone, PapGene, some really cool companies, all doing well, and one cyber company, a company called Terbium Labs. We actually started out at APL. So I was doing that, managing that portfolio. I was actually running Gemstone, which one is our biotech companies. I know anything about biotech, right? Other than from being a patient. But I think my business acumen combined with the PhD acumen, we built a pretty cool team. We raised about $4 million. Company's doing very well. I got recruited by some of my contemporaries in the space to think about TEDCO. And as I've shared with a lot of people, I told them and I told the board when I interviewed them, I didn't really know what TEDCO was. So out of the gate,
you had never been funded by TEDCO in any of your companies?
Not in my activities. Right. With Gemstone, I think we did try to get some funding out of TEDCO, and we were turned down. Believe me, I've been turned down more than anybody in the United States relative to fundraising. And if you're an entrepreneur, get ready for the word no. You got to live through it. But I just didn't know what it was. So I said, well, first of all, you got a branding issue, right? I peeled the onion and I looked at it and said, wow, what a really cool platform. You know, somebody had the wherewithal 20 years ago to figure out that we need to put capital into transferring technology. And over those years, TEDCO has survived many administrations. It's a favorite son of the legislative side. You know, we get funded about $20 million a year, which is way too small, to try to, you know, promote innovation and create great companies. So I said, maybe I can add some value here, spread my wings, use my experience. I love working with small companies, and I love Maryland, and we've got so much opportunity here. Here was a place for maybe to get on a bigger platform to do that.
And after 6 months, you have it all figured out now.
You know, at our expo, I said that some people laughed, but I said, you know, I really do. And what I mean by that is what we do is all about the startup. It's all about the entrepreneur and the innovator. It's not about us. You know, so if we coalesce our assets that we have and work well with others to make companies great, we all win. So at the center of my universe, you and I talked about this before, Rich, everybody talks about the ecosystem and they end up putting themselves in the middle. We're not in the middle of it. It's that startup. It's that entrepreneur. It's that innovator. If we put them in the middle and we all work together to make them great, we'll all win. So
that's
what
I want.
They're our customer.
Really?
They're our customer. So at the end of the day, I think I have a really cool job. You know, our mission is to foster innovation and entrepreneurship all across Maryland and to create great companies. How cool is that? So I wish I had more capital to do it with, and I'm gonna be really a big advocate of trying to raise more money or coalesce with partners to drive more capital in here to stimulate.
I agree
this
with you, George, because there are many other states that have less resources, less assets, and deploy much more capital than what Maryland does, especially with this ecosystem as you describe it, which is still evolving after how many years now?
It's taken too long.
So from a transformation standpoint, I guess you're going to be a paradigm shift guy, right?
Yeah, I am. And I was brought in to do that. But, you know, on the ecosystem and the plethora of assets, nobody knows that better than you and the work you've been doing down there. You know, you get this. And we got to figure out how to way to coalesce all these assets to really lift this up. But when I came into TEDCO, I said, look, I'm going to take my time and kind of do my own audit internally and externally. So internally of our programs, our products, how we do things here. Externally about the brand and how do we work with others. And so I think I've kind of completed most of that over the last 6 months. I focused internally originally, although I think in the last 2 months I've put almost 7,000 miles on my car. From Cumberland to St. Mary's County to the Eastern Shore.
A lot of windshield time.
I've been getting out there.
Yeah,
you know,
right.
I want to be seen and talk and reach out to all our customers. But internally, I saw, first of all, a very passionate team here. I was really pleased to see the work ethic and the desire to help and work. But there were some gaps in there based on history and acumen. I saw TEDCO a little heavy on the public sector side of people from academics. And nothing wrong, just more background there versus from the private sector and traditional venture. You know, we had the Maryland Venture Fund here under Annie Jones that is much more of a traditional venture play. We have our seed funds and our other services that have been more managed in the spirit of economic development, and that's our job and job creation. But I said, boy, what if we could merge these cultures? And what if we could tear down the old paradigm that investing for economic development and investing for ROI have to be diametrically opposed? They don't have to be, you know that. You find great companies, we all win. So I changed some things internally. I put all of the investment funds under one umbrella, under Andy. So the same people that are managing $100 million asset in the Maryland Venture Fund are also managing that $6 million seed fund.
And do you have that broken down by industry sector underneath Andy, how is that structured?
Well, we almost have to by statute. So you know, we're a quasi-private company or a quasi-public, depending on what seat you sit in. But we're not state employees, so to speak, but we get our funding from the state. And we work to a statute that's actually pretty broad, but we're allocated funds a little more specifically. So I talk about $20 million a year. We manage the Maryland Stem Cell Research Fund grant, which can be anywhere from $8 or $9 million a year. And that's focused on not just research, but now finally moving to actually funding companies that are spinning out.
And it used to be academics primarily.
It started off 100% academics. We're now reaching a higher plethora of actually funding startup companies in the regen medicine field, which we're all excited about. It's been a long cycle. We have the MII funds, which is very heavily used by research. And we're seeing more of that money go to actual companies versus institutions. So they're good things. And then we get seed funds broken out between what's called a technology commercial fund, X amount, a life science fund, X amount, a cyber fund, X amount. And then we have this new gap fund, a couple million dollars. So we kind of have to point things in those directions, but we have some leeway to blend those funds a little bit together. You know, historically, TEDCO had limited its early stage investing, which were convertible notes, at the $100,000 level. I said, what if we find a really good deal? Now let's put $200,000 in it. So we're doing some things like that, and we're bringing a more traditional venture philosophy down to the seed level, recognizing that you got to be careful here because we got to spread this pretty well. But let's find gold star companies, let's really vet them out, and let's make them winners. You know, and now I have assets to take them from research to seed, pre-seed to seed to Series A. And if I can coalesce other partners, we can build some good companies. And we've had some nice success stories recently around that space.
Yeah, we'll talk about some of those success stories. But how do you basically balance the economic development mission versus a traditional venture capital internal rate of return mission, recognizing you're a quasi-public entity and you're trying to structure and balance both sides of that scale?
It's not easy. And I'm learning a lot. You know, first of all, from a management perspective here, you know, I've got two really strong partners here. So I got John Wasilesen, who has a long history of working in the public sector. He gets it. He gets Annapolis. He gets economic development and job creation. Very passionate. And he's really helping me. And he's really helping me understand that part of the process.
Your passion is coming through on the table here, George.
I know it is. Sorry about that. I'm banging.
That's okay.
And then you got Andy Jones, who's traditional venture, well known in the system. And I know a little bit about that from my background. And then you got me kind of more, I've been an operations guy, I've been an investor, I've done it. So between the three of us, got some pretty strong acumen there. If we can blend it, we can do some really good things. So when we look at the metric of TEDCO at the top level, it's kind of a triple bottom line. You know, I think that bottom line has to be economic development gains for the state of Maryland. And the number one metric tied to that is job creation. And we've been doing that. The difference is understanding job creation on a static basis versus a long-term dynamic basis, right? You know, so we can deploy money and invest in companies that may not make it beyond a year, but at least we funded and created jobs for a year, right? But my goal is to turn that more into creating businesses that are sustainable and will grow and be bigger and stronger. Then we all win. So we're all winning with economic development, job creation, and if we invest in the right companies, we're going to get returns. You know, this is an evergreen fund here, right? So we get returns. It goes right back into the system. So I think what you're going to see us doing at the seed levels, we want to be wide. We need to do that. It's taxpayer money, and I take that very seriously. But we want to start to get deeper and find some strong winners that we can really create. I tend to borrow this from a good friend, Ron Gula, who founded the company upstairs here, Tenable Systems, and he now has Gula Ventures, giving back in a big way to Maryland. Let's build 10 Tenables. You know, that's 10,000 jobs. And that's the mindset we want to create. Let's build, you know, 10 MedImmunes. You know, let's figure out a way to create an environment that's built around real winners and success stories and growth. So we're going to figure it out. I told the team I want to prove to the world that those things don't have to be diametrically opposed, and we're going to do that. And I think we're already making some headway in that space.
So it sounds to me like you want to focus on a growth strategy, growth investment strategy.
Yep.
Maybe fewer investments in higher quality deals rather than sort of the peanut butter spread a whole bunch around in a lot of lifestyle companies. You make a lot of people happy throughout the state, but you're not going to get a great return on either jobs and or dollars.
I think you're right. And I think it's exponentially going to be better to do that for our taxpayers to get better returns and create bigger things. But at the same time, Rich, that doesn't mean we don't want to spread and help anybody that we can from an entrepreneurship and innovation perspective. So what we're working towards is a concept where you come to TEDCO and we give you money, you're going to get a box of value-added products with that. Training, development, marketing, intel, find your resources, whatever you might need.
Some of the soft services.
Traditional venture things of helping people, right? But I also want to make sure if you don't get money from us, you still get a box of products from us. So assessing what you have, redoing your presentation, better business plans, better way to train, point you to other sources of capital or partnerships. Or you know what? Sometimes just tell you, matter of factly, no. You know, there's nothing wrong with that. Eventually, people need to be told it's just not going to work. And we should have the acumen to do that. So we want to do both, and we want to be deep in that. But we have to do things at a cadence that's much more supportive of really growing a commercial environment. TEDCO time has not been known as a positive thing. I want to turn TEDCO time into prime time. So if you come to TEDCO, we need to be in a position to tell you very quickly no, and or help you try to get the yes, but this isn't going to work. If we tell you yes, I want to get you the money in a couple weeks. You know, at the seed level.
I understand.
At the higher level, you know, we got to do more diligence. And we've already seen that process starting to work here. So we're moving faster. You know, I don't have to tell you what goes through the life of an entrepreneur for 90 days. Do I sell the house? Do I get rid of the dog? You know what I mean? So we want to move quickly to really turn TEDCO time into prime time to help as many as we can. And as you and I were talking earlier, the only way for us to do that is to partner. We can't do it all. So how do we partner with you?
How do we break the silos down in the state that have existed for decades?
Haven't we all been talking about this?
Yes.
So my mission is to prove that we can work well with others and that we can offer up our customer, our joint customer, Rich, access to the best asset. Doesn't have to be mine. Could be you, could be commerce, it could be somebody else. But let's find the plethora of great resources and point our customer to them and make it easy for them to get to them.
Sounds like you're getting it after 6 months, George.
Now,
the challenge is the implementation of this vision, right?
It is. It truly is. So organizationally, we've done it. So I've got kind of three pillars of excellence now that we're managing to. One is all these investment funds under Andy. So I have a real chief investment officer in Andy Jones, and he, in addition to being the managing director of the Maryland Venture Fund, he also oversees all our seed funds. And he's working with the whole team, the old team, the new team together. And we're seeing good progress in that space, good tracking, good metrics, good ROIs down the road. And then I set up a new group, and I'm using this term today, we may change it, but it's called Gateway Services. So this is the area where we want to build a concierge suite of products and programs and partners that touch everything from basic STEM development and training at the high school level to entrepreneurship growth and innovation growth and development to how to build a business. You know, and we want to do virtual programs, but we also want to partner with excellent brand names to create really winning formulas for people. And really give, because I do hear that a lot. And you do too, right? You get a lot of these young people coming, just don't have the background experience. They need to be embraced and taught and pushed in the right direction.
We need to mentor them, really.
They're usually pretty smart.
Yeah.
And I like to say that as an entrepreneur myself, you really need two things. You need cash and you need to be connected. Connected to help, to resources, to partners, to customers, to capital. If we can coalesce all of us together to give them those things, we're going to win. And then the third pillar is kind of this business development arena of working well with others and finding bigger partners and bigger stories and taking TEDCO, turning up the gain on accessing more capital for all the companies we want to fund, whether it's state funding, private funding, partner funding. Let's figure out a way to do it.
You know, one of the things our listeners talk about a lot is basically this is called BioTalk. So one of the one of the things people have talked about in the past related to TEDCO is there hasn't been a lot of emphasis in the life science investment area. And you being a recipient of great treatment to where you are today, where hopefully you're cancer free, you understand the value of what goes on in the biohealth and life science space. I understand you have a limitation on dollars, but how do we get greater interest in a lot of the quality deals that we see emerging now in that life science and biohealth area?
Great question, Rich. And you know, the day I showed up here, there was a group, a small group here at TEDCO that had a mission to focus on bio, and they were happy I showed up because finally we had some leadership here who really got that, or at least participated in. And you're right, I did participate as a patient, so I have a little different perspective, but I was running some biotech companies, you know, I was running, and I know the value proposition and how great it can be. So we're trying to, and this is an area where you and I were just talking before this interview, where we need to work closer with you and other industry organizations around the life science and bio side. We're working very closely with the university system. We do a lot of work there in MII funds and stem cell research grants. But from the startup perspective and creation of new business, let's just face it, we haven't been very good at it in Maryland. You know, not as good as we could be, given the asset base, the acumen, the pedigree. So is it... And this isn't even touching the federal labs yet that you have a lot of play in. You know, so is it the research that's coming out of there? Is it commercial? Or is it the process between the research? I think it's the process. I see great things going on. And where's the future of life sciences? It's in a lot of places. I'm a big fan of regenerative medicine because, you know, as a cancer survivor, I realize that our major chronic diseases, cancer, heart conditions, diabetes, these things are just going to drive us to an unsustainable level of trying to treat them financially. And the only cure is going to be through some regenerative medicine solution, tissue engineering or immunotherapy. So we've got to keep investing in that and grow that. And we're seeing some good things in Maryland around that space. You know, devices, we could have a powerful play here with what's going on with
FDA.
Personalized medicine.
Vaccines we're strong on.
Absolutely. Yeah, right. Absolutely. You know, again, as a cancer survivor, personalized medicine, really important. Genome analytics and doing personalized care. And that, you know, that led me, I'll tell you a quick story about an investment. When I was doing Gamma 3, we were introduced to this company called PGDX down in Baltimore, Personal Genome Diagnostics. The founders, Luis Diaz and Victor Vasquez, unfortunately, I knew Luis pretty well because he was one of my oncologists, believe it or not. But we were pointed to them by Bert Vogelstein, who we know, and he said, this is a cool opportunity over here.
He's the most cited scientist
over at
Johns Hopkins.
Right.
Yeah, for sure.
Unbelievable.
Right.
And, you know, I realize in where science is going that maybe there's some conclusions being reached that the real secret is just early detection, you know. But PGDX was a really cool play in the genome sequencing space with real cancer specialists. And they came up with a great model to sell a product more than a service. And they're doing blood biopsies and just really advanced stuff. These guys started the company with their own credit cards. They raised some angel money from Gamma, Able Foundation. Didn't put a whole lot. Got it together, generated some revenue, and then all of a sudden we saw and said, this thing can be big. We were looking at Foundation Medicine as a comp, we're doing that. So I had a connection at NEA, introduced him to them. They were a little nervous, here comes the big guys, right? We're gonna get diluted, we're gonna get out of here. But I said, guys, you can either be a $20 million company or you can be a $1 billion company. You gotta bring the venture guys in. NEA got involved, led their Series A, they raised $25 million. They're about to close a really big Series B that I can't wait till they make the announcement. It's on its way. And they just leased more space in Baltimore. They hired 100 people in Baltimore in the last year. Hopefully that's going to be a $1 billion exit. There's our unicorn.
So that's that tenable that you have on the life science
exactly.
side. You have 10 of those too.
How do we do that?
Sure. Right.
And you know better than anybody, once they've been built, like a MedImmune or a Tenable, they start to cluster. People start to come out of there to create business.
And then we get the spin-outs, which are fantastic, which we need to have.
And we got to nurture that. We got to be there supporting them every step of that game. And the other thing I liked about the PGDX model, big venture, big story, and then they went and recruited world-class C-level execs to come to Baltimore to run this. Guys from Roche, GE Healthcare. And that's been something that ventures always said we're missing here. Well, not anymore.
No.
We're making it happen.
I basically disagree that a lot of people say we don't have the talent or can't attract the talent. If you have the right deal with the right people to surround them with, you can attract anybody from around the world to come into this region.
You're right. And as we and you and I have said on occasion, capital and talent has an uncanny ability to find winners.
Definitely.
So if we produce winners, it'll show up.
we need to do a better job of working together to do that, George.
To build the winners,
yes,
right?
Definitely.
And we need to do it with the system and our partners to say, you know, don't show up with a science project. Show up with a plan to really innovate and turn this from lab to bedside into an operational program, and you can win.
You know, one of the funny things, you and I were talking before we went on the air here, that we don't do a very good job of marketing or branding the assets of this region. And you said, I didn't know anything about TEDCO. So you know what people don't know about TEDCO? It is the second largest early stage investor in the United States, and people within their own state and region don't know that. They criticize what we don't have. They don't talk about what we do have. So why don't we start talking about, you know, we do more investing with TEDCO, even though it might be smaller dollars than most other people in the United States in numbers of deals that are invested in at an early stage.
Yeah, thank you. You know, I'll talk about specific TEDCO, but Maryland in general first. You know, I'm such a huge fan of Maryland. I'm from here, and you know, whether it's Baltimore or Montgomery County, it just doesn't matter to me. There's innovation pockets everywhere, and we got to do things. But the reality is, for some reason, Maryland does a very good job of accentuating the negative. And we have so much positive to talk about. And so there is a move afoot to do that at a broader scale, I understand. But from TEDCO, we're rolling out something called TEDCO 2.0. And it is this whole, these changes I've been telling you about, to really lift things up, to create gateway services, to do triple bottom lines, to find and coalesce capital and do things. And we announced that at our expo and got a pretty good response, working with our marketing group here to say, we got to get the messaging right. And so in addition to me being all over the place and running my gibs out there, we're doing things in social media. We're trying to get the press out. We're trying to move better and work with others. We're going to do some big announcements in January. You know, next year will be the 20th anniversary of TEDCO. So it has survived for 20 years. And when you talk about the investment side of it, you're right. You know, sometimes I sit here and go, you know, really in the seed level, we only get 5 or 6 million a year. But well, after 5 years, that's 30 million. You know, it starts to become very meaningful money because we get replenished every year. How many funds get that? So it's actually very meaningful money, and we want to make sure we get really good returns out of it. But from a messaging perspective, you're absolutely right, Rich. People got to know what we do and what we do well. We got to fix the brand. I'll let a little secret out. I wouldn't mind even changing our name someday.
Ah,
right? Why
okay.
not? Why not? We can do that.
Sure.
You know, let's recreate, let's reinvent. And if we want to be helping drive and foster innovation, dang, we better be innovative. So we're going to try to really build a platform of innovative solutions and products. And as I told you earlier, most important thing I think we can do on the fostering side is to work well with others, to partner with brands and people who get it, to really direct our customer to the best resource.
And I hope you can convey that message effectively to a couple boards you've just joined.
Yeah.
You know, Governor Hogan has formed and reappointed the Life Science Advisory Board.
Yes.
To focus on the life science industry. And then he also has created something called Excel to take it a bigger vision for the whole state of Maryland and where we need to go from an economic standpoint. So talk a little bit about, in 6 months now, you're involved with both LSAB and Excel. How do you see the role of each of those? How do they interact with one another from your perspective, and what contribution are you going to make personally to both of those?
Well, good question. And just in a nutshell, the Life Science Advisory Board and Excel are and must be connected at the hip, and we're making sure that happens. So very quickly, Excel Maryland, yes, you know, initiative commissioned by the governor back in May to take a look at what we've been talking about. You know, how do we fill the gap between this plethora of research and asset and acumen towards commercial opportunity and economic development gains? You know, not that we haven't done it badly, just how can we do it so much better? So I believe that the governor's mission is to try to really transform the way we think about economic development in Maryland. Now, that's a big statement, and there's a lot to do there. But I think with the right commitment behind it and partnership with the legislative side of the house, we can pull some things together here and make this happen. So there was a study done in Excel that's been concluded. It recognized that we need to do things differently relative to, you know, bringing assets together, working well together. We've identified and targeted certain initiatives. Some of them were announced by the governor last week. You know, some of the things we talked about at Excel and Life Science Board. So Excel's kind of focused on life science, to try to be preeminent in the world as a life science center, and we should be, as well as cyber and advanced computing and digital products. So it's kind of focused on those two things. So we talk and we go, look, the requirements have to come from industry. What's a better industry voice than a life science advisory board, particularly given the study that you guys completed last year, had all the essence of what we need to do. So Excel has adopted that as the requirements base coming from industry for life science, and we want to keep that door open. We're going to try to do something similar on the cyber side to create an industry-driven and academic-driven conglomerate of individuals who can drive better requirements. And then at a global level, can we be more intelligent the way we allocate capital and get it moving? So they're very connected.
Why is it taking so long for everybody to understand that if you've got a market-driven economy and industry drives the market, that we should engage with them? I mean, to be honest with you, when we formed BHI 6 years ago, we said the only thing we can do to change this is to be led by industry. But that really hasn't permeated throughout the whole state to where people understand how important industry is.
I think you're probably right, Rich. A lot of this public sector side of the world is very new to me. I'm a private sector guy in kind of this quasi public suit. It's a little tight, you know, but it's okay. I'm fascinated with it. I'm learning a lot. Thank God I have John and people here to help me guide me through that process. Because at the end of the day, somehow things get done and they work well. And it's a big engine. But when I look at it, I have a similar view. And I say, well, you know, I look at Maryland, which I love dearly, and it is a very public sector oriented state. You know, it generates a lot of income and revenue and livelihood from the public sector.
And it's right next to Washington, D.C.
It's right next to Washington. So I don't think anything's wrong with that. It's just reality. And so it does put up some barriers because to the things we're used to in the private sector driven economy, because by default, a public sector has a little bit more risk avoidance and process oriented mindset. Rightly so. It's managing taxpayer money, you know, and we need to be very careful and take that stewardship very seriously. So how do we blend those cultures is what I think we need to try to do, because they're both good cultures. They just have some different marching orders and they march to a different cadence. The cadence is the word I use. Yeah, it's just a little slower on the public side than the private side. So I think messaging, storytelling, we talked about that earlier, is really important.
Leadership,
highlighting our winners. Excel is all about a public-private relationship that brings top pedigree and acumen to a governing body that can figure this out together. And I think if we do nothing more than that, we have achieved a lot of bringing the, and they're already at the table now. You see it at the Life Science Advisory Board. That's a great mix of people. And be it known to those other members of that board, it is being heard at all levels. And that is become the voice, the industry voice, to this Excel level committee for life sciences.
We have a lot of people on listening to this that really are looking for money. So if I'm an entrepreneur out there, whether it's cybersecurity, technology, biohealth, and TEDCO's got a pot of money, what is it somebody needs to do to be prepared to come in and be received well by TEDCO to be considered seriously for an investment?
From a very macro perspective and in a traditionalist perspective, recognize that your idea isn't worth anything. You know, an idea just is worth nothing. Unless you have the wherewithal to be innovative and create a plan and entrepreneurship understanding to drive that idea to a product of value for consumption, it just isn't worth anything. And sometimes we see a lot of great ideas and there's nothing behind it. There's no acumen or understanding of taking it to market, particularly on the life science side. You know how hard it is, Rich. I mean, it's a hard process to get a product approved. So if you don't do your homework, you may have gotten some money from TEDCO in the past, you're not going to get in the future. We're looking for leadership. We're looking for great technology and ideas. That's going to define itself. We're going to see that, or we'll find people who can help us justify that. But we're looking for leadership in who's running it. Do they get it? Are they willing to listen and be trained and understand? Do they understand the basics of setting up a company? You know, do you understand the complexity of an LLC or setting up QuickBooks to manage your financials? You know, on the life science side, do you understand the plethora of channels you have to go through to get a product to market, both regulatory as well as reimbursable, clinical? And really, do you understand how much it's going to cost to get there? And do you have a plan to create value to garnish that type of capital? Do you have others interested? We're always, most of our funding requires you have some type of other funding with you. We don't want to be first in. We wouldn't mind, but we prefer you at least match that. So there is some other interest and we can garnish it. Andy's team now is being a lot more proactive in the out there. So we're not, you can put applications in here unsolicitedly and we review all of them, but we're really out there in the field. So get yourself known, get understood, get in the system, figure out where to be, because our guys are out searching for winners all the time. So get prepared. Make sure you understand what it means to be investor ready when you show up. And if you don't think you get that, come to us anyway before you ask for the money and ask for that help. Or come to you. You know, you do a lot of that work on the life science side. And you and I both know what that means. A lot of these, and I won't just say young people, people just don't have any experience. What do you mean by investor ready? We know what that means. And having a good, sensible plan, presentation, acumen, understanding, then you get that behind you, then it's all about an operational program and a plan in your science. So be ready when you come here now, because it's not just about presenting a science project to us.
So listen to what George is saying. This is George Davis, by the way, the CEO for TEDCO we've been talking to, and we could go on for hours, George. But we have to.
You and I this, could, yes.
Yeah, so we'll have to do version two someday. Yeah. But we have to bring this somewhat to a close. I'm going to ask you a couple things. You've been around 6 months now. You've had a chance to look at the ecosystem and the environment that TEDCO functions in. If you had to look at the major gaps, the macro gaps that you believe have to be addressed that you can make a difference in, what are they?
Again, macro level, it's pretty obvious that in Maryland, we don't really have an integrated, viable innovation ecosystem. We have a fragmented cluster of siloed things, all well-intended, but just not marching together. And hence, we're not deploying capital intelligently and efficiently. So one thing that TEDCO is going to do is prove that we can work well with others and try to coalesce that together. You know, whether it's our job or not, we're going to do it because it's just important. So we're going to find strong partners. The gaps that I see in from an economic development and growth perspective are, we still believe there is a gap in entrepreneurial education talents here, but education, training, and development, really good programs to teach people how to move a product and
maybe
a program.
Surrounding them with great advisors and advisory boards.
Exactly. Surrounding them with good mentorship, good advisorship that they can go to and really get what they need to do. And then the other gap, obviously, is access to venture capital. We talked about capital finds winners, but at the same time, venture capital likes to sleep in its own bed. It doesn't travel well. So we have to develop more of a cluster of winning opportunities here so it starts to show up. You've been to Cambridge as much as I have, and you walk down the street, and in between MIT and Harvard is a therapeutic company, and in between them is a sign on the door that's some venture capital company. We got to try to create that dense placemaking opportunity here, Montgomery County, Baltimore, the different areas, to really coalesce assets, because entrepreneurs love community. They love community and they love to work with others and be around others. And the more you have, the more you have the ability to recruit talent because they're not afraid to fail because there's a lot of opportunity in the region. So I think, you know, coalescing assets, working well together, doing a better job of training and developing talent, hopefully all that will help dictate more venture capital, but we always need more capital. I mean, you're just going to need that. So I think they're probably my top three. And we can help in all those. We're trying to partner with others to bring capital in. We've already talked about doing better training programs. So hopefully we can move the needle on all of that. I can't do it by myself, obviously.
Well, we're here to help you,
George. I know you are.
Yeah,
I know
definitely.
You are.
We need to work more closely together, yep. For sure. Last thing, open mic. You can say anything you want to the listeners out there about George, your vision, or whatever you'd like to talk about related to TEDCO.
Mostly to those out there who are bold enough and have the courage to try to start a business and create something new. Nothing warms my heart more than meeting those types of people and helping them. Know that your pathway is extremely hard and you will take a lot of arrows. Hopefully they're in your back, right? Because you're moving forward. Pioneering something is hard. It's really hard stuff. So you can't come in and just dip your toe in the water. You got to be prepared to jump in. And preparation means coming to us, searching for help, getting the acumen you need to do it. And I think, you know, if we can scale this the right way, working well together and find these people, it's all about people at the end of the day in leadership. Man, what we can do in Maryland. We really can reach levels of preeminence not seen before because the core assets are here. You know that better than anybody. So let's make it happen. Let's look, you know, you can't have a vision of 6 months. You got to have a vision probably 5 to 10 years. And we need to understand that and work together, public, private, investing, co-investing, supporting each other to get there. But my view is, you know, 5 years from now, We're holding big venture conferences in Maryland, you know, in life science.
We don't have to wait 5 years, do we?
No, let's do it next year.
How about that?
Let's do it next year. You know, we're creating a culture and an environment that's a mindset. I'll leave it with this. John Doerr, pretty famous investor from Kleiner Perkins, was asked about replicating Silicon Valley, you know, as it was growing. And he said, don't think of Silicon Valley as a geographical footprint. Think of it as a mindset. And that's the mindset we want to create here. And I'm looking forward to helping do that.
Yes, that fantastic vision. I like that comment, too, because everybody talks about Baltimore and Montgomery County, 35 miles, the longest 35 miles in the world. Forget about it. If it's a mindset, there is no distance in between getting all of the assets and resources to work together within this network.
You ever drive from San Francisco to Silicon Valley?
Yes.
It's a tough ride.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, it's a tough ride.
Somehow it works.
They have broken down that barrier.
They've broken it down. Thank you, Rich.
Yeah. So this has been George Davis, CEO of TEDCO. It's been really refreshing. I like your vision. We want to help. We want you to be successful. We want more money to come into TEDCO to invest into this ecosystem. We'll do everything we can do to support you, George.
Thanks, Rich. Look forward to working with
you. Thank you for being on the show.
Thanks for listening to BioTalk with Rich Bendis.